the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Good morning, I'm Rain Musni. Here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. The Omicron variant now detected in at least 16 U.S. states. Over 2,000 students in Metro Manila returned to classrooms for the first time since the pandemic struck. And at least 14 people are dead following a volcanic eruption in Indonesia. The Omicron variant has reached at least 16 U.S. states. The latest was detected in Louisiana from an individual who had traveled within the U.S. Many of the cases are fully vaccinated individuals with mild symptoms. Dr. Anthony Fauci, America's top infectious disease expert, says it does not look like there is a great severity to the new variant, but he notes that it's still too early to draw conclusions. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control, meanwhile, says the Delta variant still accounts for 99.9% of COVID cases nationwide. Vaccines are known to protect against hospitalization and death against the Delta variant, so health officials hope they will blunt the impact of Omicron as well. The U.S. has averaged 119,000 infections and 1,300 deaths a day over the last 7 days. Senegal records its first case of the Omicron variant. A testing lab says the patient is a tourist who attended a demonstration in Dakar last month with about 300 people in varying nationalities. The 58-year-old man was visiting from another West African country and tested positive as he was about to leave Senegal last Friday. He's currently under quarantine and is asymptomatic. The British government reintroduces travel restrictions due to the threat of the Omicron variant. Travelers heading to the United Kingdom must show negative COVID-19 test results taken within 48 hours before departure. The rule will be implemented beginning December 7th. It will apply to all travelers aged 12 and above. The UK also added Nigeria to its travel red list after England reported 21 Omicron infections linked to the country. In total, the United Kingdom has so far detected 246 cases of the new COVID variant. Here at home, at least two COVID-19 referral hospitals in Metro Manila say they are prepared for the possibility of a surge in infections following the emergence of the new Omicron variant. This after initial research showed the latest variant may be causing more reinfections among COVID survivors. The Philippine General Hospital and Lung Center of the Philippines have been admitting more non-coronavirus patients lately, but they say they are ready to reconvert their non-COVID wards if necessary.
Ang nagiging hamon naman ngayon sa PGH ay yung pagdami ng mga non-COVID patients, no? Kahapon nga ay nagkaroon ng parang nagka-surge doon sa aming emergency room.
Tuloy-tuloy naman ang pasok ngayon ng mga non-COVID lung cases namin.
The Philippines logged 603 new COVID infections Sunday, bringing the country's total to 2,834,000. The health department also confirmed 156 new deaths, but it says only 12 of those occurred in December, while the rest were late reports due to issues with its data system. Active cases now stand at 13,852, the lowest since June 1 last year. The Okta Research Group believes case numbers will remain low this month, even with the threat of the Omicron variant.
Even if the protection is lower, because so many of our kababayans have been vaccinated in Manila and in many of the metropolitan, the cities are protected now.
Over 37.3 million people, our Filipinos, have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19 as of December 2. More than 2,000 elementary and senior high school students in Metro Manila return to face-to-face classes today after nearly 2 years of COVID-induced school closures. 28 schools were selected across the capital region to join the pilot phase of in-person learning, which began in mid-November. The Education Department says the necessary protocols are in place in case a student or personnel tests positive for the coronavirus.
Na lahat ng mga eskwelahan ay dapat handa dito at ang atin pong instruction ay kung meron na lalabas na kaso, whether whatever variant, ay istap po kaagad yung ating implementation.
Teachers and students who will participate in the face-to-face classes have already been tested and cleared from the coronavirus. But a teachers group hopes more steps will be taken to ensure their safety.
At kailangan natin protektado yung ating mga teachers. Yung retrofitting ng ating mga schools, di naman natin minumungkahing may mga barrier, yung mga plastic or whatever barrier, kasi nagpe-prevent ito sa flow ng nung air. Kailangan na merong standby na doctors din at nurse. Gusto nilang mag-mandatory ng testing, di dapat ilibre ito.
And let's now go to Comembo Elementary School in Makati City, which is among the schools that began limited face-to-face classes this morning. Our correspondent Ara Perez joins us live for an update. Ara, good morning. What more can you tell us?
Good morning, Rain. Here in Comembo Elementary School, 72 kinder to grade 3 students are participating in in-person classes after almost 2 years of purely using modules and online classes. The flag ceremony started at 7 in the morning, and then students proceeded to the hand-washing facility. This is the move or the step of the school to instill to the students the act of keeping their self and their hands and their surroundings clean. After washing their hands, the students proceeded to the classroom for their morning routine, which was an exercise, and then the actual classes started. Students are now eating their snacks at their desks. The classrooms here in Makati are equipped with UV light and air purifier. Their windows are open and the electric fan is being used instead of the air conditioner. The administration of the school said this is their move to facilitate a better air ventilation for students. We also went to Pasig Elementary School this morning, wherein 27 students from grades 1 and 2 are participating in face-to-face classes. Unlike here in Makati, in Pasig, there was no flag ceremony and students were asked to immediately go to their classrooms, wherein the classes also started with the routine, their exercise, and the actual classes. Teachers from both Pasig and Makati are saying that they are trying to give students a semblance of normalcy through teaching the way they used to teach before the pandemic, but just with the constant reminder that students must observe health protocols and the minimum health standards. DepEd and ASEC Malcolm Garma also went around these schools. He said that he is happy and satisfied with the preparations, both in the health protocols aspect and the teaching aspect. And this just proves, he said, that this just proves that it is really possible to conduct face-to-face classes amid the pandemic. Rain?
Ada, did you get a chance to talk with the teachers, the school staff, or some of the students on how they feel about going back to school now?
Students and teachers saying the same sentiment. They are excited and happy about going back to school. Even the parents are also thrilled, because this time they won't be the one teaching their students, but their teachers. Parents are saying that their children are constantly looking for their teachers, although they appreciate their parents and guardians' help with their studies, but they're saying it's really different in school. So they're hoping that this pilot run of face-to-face classes will continue, so that more improvements could be done and more students, more schools could also participate in this pilot run. Rain?
Ada, just a last question. We understand you mentioned that 72 kids are there in face-to-face classes right now, but this is a minority of the total number of students who should be going to school. Is that only grade 1 to 3? Is that correct?
Yeah, from kinder to grade 3, the actual population of this school is about 2,000 students or more. But the principal of the school said, and also based on DepEd's guidelines, only 16 students are allowed per classroom. So that's one consideration, the class size. And the second, you're right, some parents are still hesitant to bring back their students to school. Some parents are saying that they would wait for the result, or they would look into the events or happenings here during the pilot face-to-face classes before they could finally decide to let their children go back to school.
Hopefully they will remain safe and the pilot testing will be successful. Ara Perez reporting to us live from Makati City. Thank you so much. Well, the COVID situation in Philippine jails showing signs of improvement. The Bureau of Jail Management and Penology says there's only one active COVID case in the entire jail system right now. No new infection has been reported in 8 days. If this continues, granular visits for inmates may soon be reinstated. BJMP spokesperson Xavier Solda says they are now preparing guidelines for this.
Ang magiging sistema natin sa jail, isang pamilya lamang ang papayagan sa mga dadalaw. Bawal po muna ang mga bata at hanggang isang oras lamang po, no, ang papayagan ng oras ng dalaw. 119,070 out of 125,589 were already vaccinated. Ibig sabihin po nito, ang aming total percentage of PDL vaccinated ay umabot na ng 94.84%. Samantala, 95,813, so 119,070 na PDL ay fully vaccinated na.
Well, the Philippine Interior and Local Government Department will issue show cause orders against local officials over political gatherings held in their areas. The agency says local governments will be asked if health protocols were implemented during those events. The DILG is also finalizing guidelines for political sorties to prevent super spreader events.
Dapat yan, may mga organizer yung mga ano na yun eh. Tapos ngayon,
FDU.
Oh, pagdating sa politiko, yun ang nasa COMELEC na yan. Pag pumunta sila sa isang barangay o isang bayan o kung halimbawa ano, aba, gastusan nila security. Dapat gastusan nila ang security to follow the health protocol. Mag-hire sila ng maraming security para ma-observe natin social distancing.
Well, the Philippines' Election Commission has denied the accreditation of 107 partyless groups eyeing seats in Congress in the 2022 elections. That's according to the poll body's spokesperson, Director James Jimenez. Among the partyless groups denied were Nurses United, LGBT+, and transport groups Manibela, TDP Truck Drivers PH, and even the group of veteran actress Nora Honor, the National Organization for Responsive Advocacies for the Arts. Jimenez says the denial stems from issues with requirements and representation.
For the most part, syempre iba-iba yung dahilan, ano, for the denial. Pero for the most part, ang nakita natin, pinakamaraming dahilan siguro ay yung hindi nila pagtugon sa requirements ng accreditation process. But the rest, may mga issues tungkol sa kanilang representation of the sector that they claim to represent.
So far, there are over 160 accredited party lists. Former presidential spokesman and lawmaker Harry Roque says he wants to provide compensation to all victims of human rights violations in the Philippines if he wins a Senate seat next year. Roque had previously backed efforts for the indemnification of victims of martial law during the dictatorship of the late Ferdinand Marcos. His statement comes as he faces backlash for endorsing the presidential candidacy of Marcos' son, Bongbong. But Roque says Marcos Jr. isn't involved in any of the cases of his parents.
The reality is, whether or not the Marcos' siblings will admit it, is that their parents have been the subject of jurisprudence, that there is ill-gotten wealth that has in fact been confiscated and part of it is given to the victims, and that there is even an American case saying that their parents are responsible for the gravest violations of human rights. But there is a distinction between the parents and the child. And I feel strongly about convicting anyone solely by reason of association because I was a victim of it as well. It's not fair. But beyond that, there are other reasons, of course. No other party adopted me. Who am I to complain? And the fact that it was very difficult not to endorse also the candidate of my own political candidate, no, Inday Sara Duterte.
In other news, Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi and UDENA Chairman Dennis Uy opened to withdrawing the libel suit they filed against nearly two dozen media practitioners if they publicly apologize to them. That's according to Cusi and Uy's lawyer, Attorney Rui Alberto Rondain. The two have accused 17 journalists of reporting false and libelous statements on their involvement in the controversial Malampaya deal. Cusi and Uy are facing a graft complaint before the ombudsman over UDENA's acquisition of a 90% stake in Malampaya, but Rondain claims the journalists involved merely based their stories on a press conference held by the complainants, as an actual complaint had yet to be filed at that time.
If you see something that's filed and docketed, it's stamped, received, then you can rely on that. That becomes an official proceeding and you can report on it without fear of a libel. They say that there was a complaint, but no one has seen, I haven't seen the complaint and no one has shown me a complaint. They said terrible things about it being the biggest crony case in history, biggest crony gift in history, about a massive graft. Imagine how their children feel, imagine how they feel. So they have to vindicate their honor by filing the libel cases. But I'm sure my clients are open to it, a sincere apology, a genuine apology.
Well, good news for motorists. A big-time oil price rollback is set this week. Gasoline prices may go down by up to 2 pesos and 70 centavos per liter. Diesel and kerosene prices may see slightly bigger price cuts of 2 pesos and 80 centavos per liter. Industry players say the drop in local pump prices is due to declining demand in the world oil market as more countries impose travel bans due to the Omicron variant. A volcanic eruption in Indonesia leaves at least 14 people dead. That's next on the lowdown.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back. At least 14 people are dead and dozens are injured in Indonesia following the eruption of the Semeru volcano. As this report tells us, hot volcanic sediment and heavy rains could complicate rescue efforts.
Drone footage on Sunday showed an Indonesian town almost buried in volcanic ash after Mount Semeru erupted in East Java. The volcano threw up towers of ash and hot clouds on Saturday that blanketed nearby villages and sent residents fleeing in panic. One evacuee told Reuters of the sudden terror.
At first, I thought it was a bomb explosion, and all of a sudden it was Semeru erupting and spewing volcanic ashes. Suddenly, it was all dark, like it was going to destroy the earth. My children were scattered around, my husband was not around, and I was waiting for him. Then we evacuated ourselves to the evacuation camp.
Indonesia's disaster agency, BNPB, on Sunday said the eruption killed at least 14 people and injured dozens on Java Island. A BNPB official said around 1,300 people have been evacuated, while 9 people remain unaccounted for. A weather official on Sunday said heavy rain is expected for the next 3 days, which could complicate evacuation and rescue efforts.
Yangon residents beat pots and pans to protest from their homes against the brutal crackdown of a peaceful gathering. A local news portal reports 5 people were killed and at least 15 arrested after Myanmar security forces in a car rammed into an anti-coup protest on Sunday morning in Yangon. Another protest was held in the city in the afternoon despite the morning violence. Anti-military protests are continuing despite the killing of more than 1,300 people since the February 1 coup. The scattered protests are often small groups voicing opposition to the overthrow of the elected government and the return of military rule. The ruling junta has yet to comment on Sunday's incident. In the U.S., the parents of a Michigan teenager accused of murdering 4 fellow high school students now in police custody. Authorities began searching for James and Jennifer Crumbly after they were each charged with 4 counts of involuntary manslaughter in connection with a campus mass shooting. They were expected to appear for Friday arraignment, but they stopped responding to calls from their lawyers, prompting a search by local and federal authorities. Prosecutors say the son as a Christmas present and then ignored warning signs that could have prevented the massacre. 15-year-old Ethan Crumbly was being held without bail and has been charged as an adult on suspicion of carrying out the deadliest U.S. school shooting this year. Over in Canada, airlines, police forces, school boards, and even banks have announced strict mandatory vaccine policies. But as employers grapple with staffing shortages, some companies were forced to offer regular COVID-19 testing in lieu of vaccine mandates. Canadian provinces have also lifted mandatory COVID jabs for hospital workers. Previously, Canada has required government employees to be vaccinated, leaving more than 1,000 workers on unpaid leave, with thousands others at risk. China's securities regulator says it respects the decision of some Chinese companies to delist from the New York Stock Exchange. But it says reports that Chinese regulators are urging firms to drop their U.S. listings are completely misleading. It adds local companies are actively working Chinese regulators to have their shares listed abroad. China's statement comes after DD said it's planning to delist from the New York Stock Exchange just 5 months after its debut. DD has been under fire in China as Beijing implements a sweeping regulatory crackdown. But authorities there assert recent policy moves are not aimed at specific industries. On to sports now, boxing greats Manny Pacquiao and Floyd Mayweather set to face off again, but this time within a basketball match. The Philippines' fighting center, gunning for the country's top post, says this will be a charity basketball game. It's expected to be held next month.
Ang purpose namin is a basketball game, sports yan eh. So yun ang ano namin. Kung ano man yung politika natin dito, sa atin ito. Iba naman yun sa amin, sa sports yun, basketball. Wala nang ibang time eh. Kasi katatapos ko lang lumaban nung August. So, after nung August, wala naman tayong ginagawang activity. So, basketball na lang.
Pacquiao and Mayweather faced off in 2015 in boxing's highest grossing match, with Mayweather coming out the victor. And that's the rundown. I'm Rain Musngi. We'll be back with more news at 11. Keep it here on ANC.
Filipinos are facing a critical crossroad in the country's history and democracy with the 2022 May elections just around the corner. With a pandemic still raging, the stakes are high in the 2022 elections. Make informed decisions this May. Let ANC help you. Get to know the presidential and vice presidential candidates on Dateline Philippines. The senatorial bets on Head Start. The party list candidates on Top Story, the local candidates on After the Fact, and various election-related issues on Rundown at 7 a.m. The business community will also sound off on the elections on Market Edge. Your vote, our country, our future.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.